welcome all of you, and we're thankful that you're here tonight. We welcome those on live stream also. We appreciate your fellowship. Tonight will be our 27th exposition of the Gospel of John. We're going to be in the second chapter, verses 23 through 25. That'll be conclude the second chapter. Now, I wanted to make a few observations before we begin here. You've noticed this, that, well, I trust you've noticed this, that wherever Jesus went, he became the prominent person. It didn't make any difference if he was among his enemies or among his friends, whether he was in a synagogue, standing on a seashore, sitting on a mountain, or in a temple. Yeah. Wherever Jesus was, he was absolutely prominent. Yeah. This, of course, is because he is prominent. Yeah. You can ever get Jesus into the situation, everybody will know something's happened. And if Jesus is present, he will not remain in the background. He will not. Men may try and push him back there. He'll pop up. He'll stand up or speak up or he'll do something. Jesus will not stay in the background because he's not that kind of person. He's a prominent person. Now, there are numberless individuals who regularly meet in professed Christian assemblies that remain abysmally ignorant of the Lord Jesus Christ. No one is able to estimate how many millions of people we're talking about. May even be in the billions. It's true that this can be because of obstinance, you know, and hard-heartedness. Some of this is due to that. But when the condition continues on, something's fundamentally wrong because obstinate and hard-hearted people get off the ship. They don't stay. I know this is true. I've lived through this. You must know it's true. If you keep on delivering the powerful word of God, finally people don't like it, just leave. Good riddance. That's how I feel about it. A lot of this condition is traced to false prophets, false teaching, false priests. That's how it was in Israel. Sometimes God would diagnose their dilemma, and he'd bring this thing up about their priests and their prophets and their teachers. I give you some texts here, and he traces it back to them. Same thing at Corinth. They had this trouble at Corinth. He traced it back to people preaching a false Christ and a false gospel, see, you know, an erroneous spirit. Same thing at Galatia. Some people came in and exploited them. See, same thing with Jude. False prophets crept in unaware. See, so this is where this stuff largely comes from. Now, our text will confirm that where Jesus is found, he will work like no other person works. And he'll always do his Father's business. You cannot divert Jesus. Amen. There have been people trying to do it. Yeah. Then people try to get him off on a bypass or a tributary. You cannot divert Jesus. If you try and get Jesus to do something that he's not intended to do, he'll just leave you standing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Believe me when I tell you this, and I'm telling you the truth. That Jesus cannot be diverted. I came to do my Father's will, and that's the only will he's going to do.
Yeah.
And if you want him to do what you want, you got to want what God wants.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, these are no good things, known things. I just thought to rehearse them a little bit. Jesus said, I must work the works of him that sent me while it's day. See, there's a window.
Yeah.
Jesus had this work to do it, but he's given a window. I got to do this work. I must do the work while it's day. The night comes when no man can work. So the opportunity is going to pass by. Jesus wouldn't let it pass by. He said, now my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work.
Yeah.
See?
Amen.
Now, God has an objective for everyone here in the room. You're rolling the body, he puts you where he wants you, he'll endue you with what's needed to do it and so forth, but you've got to determine to end up the kind of thing God wanted when he saved you.
Yeah.
That's how you're going to have to leave this world, the kind of person God wanted, intended for you to be. One time, the people told Jesus, better watch out, Herod's going to kill you. Well, he said, go tell that fox, probably a baby fox, go tell that fox, behold, I cast out devils. I do cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I'll be perfected. So that's my agenda. Go give my agenda to Herod. Now, I don't mind telling you, it's time for God's people to publish their agenda.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Much as in me is, I'm going to finish my course.
Yes.
Amen.
Just say it.
Mm-hmm.
As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Just say it.
Yeah.
Declare it. And have a strong faith. That's the consistent manner of Jesus. That's just how he was. When he ministered.
Yeah.
See, professing Christians have grown accustomed to Christless environments.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Now, he's not in these environments, and anyone pretends they are, they've betrayed that they have not got it in the head or the heart. But if Jesus isn't someplace, the least we can do is say he's not here. That's what the angel said to the women. He's not here when they came to the tomb. He's not here.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can go places and you can actually make this assessment. He's not here.
Mm-hmm.
You got to know that. You understand?
Yeah.
So all of this situation is owing to what the scriptures call a spirit of slumber. That's Romans 11:8. And it means that a table, these words are in there, that a table they've been eaten from has become a snare and a stumbling block. That's what that text says. Their table has become a snare and a stumbling block to him and a recompense unto them. All right, now having said that, let's get down to this text because we're going to deal with some of these things. Chapter 2, verse 23 through 25. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover in the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But, Jesus did not commit himself to them because he knew all men and needed not that any should testify of man, for he knew what was in man.
Yes.
When he was in Jerusalem, now, unless you do a little bit of research on this, it might surprise you that there's not many, that many times Jesus is said to have been in Jerusalem. And most all of them are toward the end when he was going to go to Jerusalem to lay down his life.
Yeah.
And a considerable part of each gospel is considered to the last few days of Jesus' life. Jesus did, Mark says he entered into the temple, Mark 1:11. He also mentioned Jesus teaching in the temple, Mark 12:35. All of this is toward the tail end of his ministry. He delivered the Olivet discourse after he had left the temple. The triumphal entry was in Jerusalem. That was toward the last. And our text is during one of the times he was in Jerusalem for the Passover. And John reports that many believed in his name when he's in Jerusalem. When he was in Jerusalem at the Passover and the feast day, many believed in his name. Let me give that to you out of some of the other versions. Came to have faith in his name. Trusted in his name. Believed in him. Began to trust him. Were convinced he was indeed the Messiah. Became believers in him. Trusted in him. Put their faith in him. Well, I'll tell you right up front, the text is going to show us that these definitions are not altogether right. The students of the lexicons and so forth. I'm a student of lexicons. I know about lexicons. I've got several of them. But I'll tell you, they're not commentaries.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They tell you more about what Greek philosophers said.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So these, and the translators, they didn't have it. These translators didn't have the Spirit of God. That's why they had to depend on these other lexical definitions.
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean to believe in his name? All right, well, the name of the Savior is mentioned several places in Scripture.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to start there.
Mm-hmm.
One of his names was Emmanuel,
yeah, right.
Isaiah 7:14. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. See?
Yeah.
They believed in his name.
Yeah.
See, now these are Jewish people. These aren't Gentile people.
Yeah, that's right.
These aren't USA Christians.
Yeah.
These are Jews.
Mm-hmm.
Believed in his name. They were able to make a connection between what the prophet said and who this person was that had cleaned out the temple. And he's called also in Isaiah 47:4, the Holy One of Israel. That was one of his names. And another was the Lord our righteousness, Jeremiah 23:6. They believed in his name. So I'm going to call this like an intellectual faith. This is the one. An intellectual believing. The people didn't deny he was the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Like the scribes and Pharisees, they did.
Yeah.
They denied he was the Christ. Yeah. These people didn't deny that he was the Christ. But they weren't believing to the saving of the soul.
Uh-huh.
See?
Yeah.
Hebrews 10:39 speaks, we believe to the saving of the soul. We know that's not what they did because of what the text is going
that's
to
right.
say.
Yeah.
It's a surface kind of faith. It's a surface kind of believing. It's kind of up on the surface. It doesn't have any depth to it. And there is a kind of believing like that. It's just up on the,
mm-hmm.
like a spider walking on water.
Yeah.
It doesn't have any depth to it. Such people, they know Jesus is not an ordinary man. I mean, they know this. And they do know he doesn't do ordinary things. They know this. And yet they imagine they can use Jesus to fulfill their own desires.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So they don't really connect Jesus really with God. It's really with me.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they view him.
Mm-hmm.
They did this when they saw his miracles. They believed in him when they saw the miracles that he did. See, so I told you, Jesus always does something where he is. So here he is in Jerusalem. We have no idea what these were, how many there were, but he worked many miracles enough to get the attention of people. Yeah, brother.
Yeah, I think you're on to something here when you talked about they're going to use Jesus for the fulfillment of their own desires.
That's right.
Yeah.
And that's why he wouldn't entrust himself.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think this is the same type of situation that we see later in John in chapter 6, where it says after he multiplied the loaf, they said, let's make him king. It says Jesus, he wouldn't entrust himself to them to be used like that.
That's right.
For their own ends.
That would have diverted him from his purpose.
Yes.
Yeah. As I say, there's no itemization of what he did, and several times in Scripture it's like that. He just said he did a lot, but didn't itemize it. Like he said, in Matthew 12:50, great multitudes followed him, and he healed them all. See, now it doesn't give you any details. Or again, Matthew 14:14, Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude, and moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. So he doesn't give you any details there. And again, great multitudes came unto him, having with them those that were lame and blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Jesus' feet, and he healed them. See, so there's no details. Matthew 19:2, and great multitudes followed them, and he healed them there. See, so Jesus did a lot, but no details. Now, I'll be perfectly honest with you. That appeals to me. You want to say Jesus has done so much, we can't get bogged down in the details, but he's just done a lot. So much is hard to think of details. It's better to think of it in his quantum, in his quantity. Many wonderful works.
If all his works were recorded, the books couldn't contain them.
Yeah, that's just the works after he rose from the dead.
Yeah, yeah.
That John's talking about, yeah. Now, I want to remember now the region that we're talking about here. The people in this region were sitting in great darkness. So you got to kind of remember that. Until John the Baptist, there had not been a known prophet for a long time. And suddenly, just a burst of heavenly light occurs in this region. It's lit up with the glory of God. And Jesus, when he was there, he revealed the impotence of Satan. See, nobody got any idea that Satan was impotent.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when Jesus turned up, he had the demons. He had him confessing and backing up and saying, please, please, you know. And they hadn't seen anything like that before. When Jesus fed the 5,000, those who had seen the miracle, John 6:14 said, this is of a truth, that prophet that should come into the world. See, they believed in him. See?
Yeah.
They saw the Messiah as someone who could rectify their situation. Continual bread. We'll be kind of like the Moses in Israel.
Yeah.
Well, they thought a lot like people today.
That's right.
This is how people today think.
Uh-huh.
They don't know, what can Jesus do for me? I mean, they'll just come out and tell you that's what they're seeking.
Uh-huh.
What can Jesus do for me?
Jesus did come to give them continual bread, but that was he himself.
That's right.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
He blesses those that seek him for his own sake.
That's right. Mm-hmm. See, people, my father used to say, he would see someone currently say, they're living in an exceedingly small world. But they wanted Jesus to adapt
That's right.
to their exceedingly small world and kind of make life more pleasant here.
Many teachers encourage that kind of thinking.
Oh, I know it.
What Jesus could do for them and how he could fix their problems and resolve this issue.
That's how he's generally presented in our time. That's how, at least in the public arena, this is how he's being presented.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can see when he died, their aspirations were burst. We thought he was the one. We thought he was going to take, you know, deliver us from Rome and all this. They had all these anticipations. Oh, yeah. But he didn't fulfill.
Now, if Jesus were to turn up and walk among us today, I know the churches would try about a campaign for him to be president of the USA. I know that would happen. Just as sure as I'm standing here, that would happen. But Jesus would turn him down.
Is he's perceived as a savior within the context of earthly life, but Jesus came to give eternal life.
That's right. Well, they think of savior as different. You know, even the saving is different.
Yeah.
See, Jesus, he knows that these same people, a few days from hence, are going to be saying, "Crucify him." Yeah. These same people that believed in him. These same people. Now, but Jesus did not commit himself to them. Other versions read this way. New American Standard. On his part, was not entrusted himself to them. The NIV says he would not entrust himself to them. Basic Bible says he didn't have faith in them. That is, he didn't trust their judgment. He did not put self into their hands. See, the word commit or entrust comes from a word that means place confidence in. And it is true that Jesus, a couple of times, asked, "What would you like me to do?" And the blind man said, "That I may receive my sight." See, if it had been a USA blind man, he said, "How about talking to the people to give more money when they pass by? If you could, Lord, I'd like to have a new cloak." Yeah. Really, this is how people think. They think of Jesus just this way. Today, in the church, this is how they think. They think in terms of relieving their immediate circumstance. Now, Jesus can do that. I mean, I understand that. But here's a perspective of Jesus that's not often observed. He didn't commit himself to them. All right, I'm going to cite you some examples here of people Jesus wouldn't let talk about him. Well, first, some demons to the witness stand. The demons, upon his word, came out of people and said, "Thou art Christ, the Son of God." All right, when Peter said that, Jesus said, "Oh, blessed art thou." And that's not what Jesus said to them. He rebuked them and suffered them to outspeak. Shut up. Don't speak. You know I'm Christ.
Amen.
Don't speak it.
Yeah.
Now, there's some people need to be told that.
Yeah.
Don't tell people you're a Christian while you're living around out of marriage and stuff like this.
Yeah.
Drop that name.
Yeah.
That's how Jesus is here. This is how Jesus is. Now, this is the real Jesus.
Amen.
Don't speak. He didn't say you can be one of my disciples. We'll have here's some demons. They made the good confession.
Yeah.
So we'll let them be. We'll have converted demons. That'll really bring a lot of press. Here's another. Jesus told 10 lepers whom he healed, "Tell no man." Again, he charged his own disciples, the 12. He said they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. How about that? When he healed a man who was deaf and had an impediment of speech, he charged them that they should tell no man, the man and those that saw it. Don't tell anybody what I just did. After Peter, James, and John had been with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, they saw Jesus transfigured. They heard God speak from heaven. And Jesus charged them. It's a command.
Yeah.
He charged them that they should tell no man what things they'd seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead.
Yeah.
After raising Jairus' daughter, that was quite an event. Uh-huh. He calls the parents in and he said they should tell no man what was done. Mm-hmm. Don't you tell anybody I raised your daughter. Mm. And the question we're going to seek to answer is, why did he say that? Mm. Why did he not allow? Now, after Jesus rose from the dead, he told him, get out and tell it, you know.
That's right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's because those who are novices and lack understanding, they are said to have weak faith, mm-hmm. as Romans 14, 1. Mm-hmm. See, faith isn't like a fixed steel ball. So whoever has faith, it's all the same. No, there's a weak faith, and then there's strong faith.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
See, there's two kinds. Jesus wants people with weak faith to keep quiet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As was the case of those who saw his miracles and believed in him. Their faith was just surface, see? Mm-hmm. They really didn't comprehend I'm not going to ask them what they want me to do. Mm-hmm. Faith that is based upon what you personally have experienced is not mature faith. Mm-hmm. We recognize it's faith.
Yeah.
We don't deny it's faith. Mm-hmm. But it's not mature faith. Mm-hmm. Mature faith is when you've seen the implications and the involvements of Jesus Christ being the Son of God.
Uh-huh.
When that kind of broadened out, you begin to see this. Now you can start talking.
That's right. Yeah.
Can you see that?
Like when Abraham is on the way to sacrifice his son, and he's reasoning God's going to raise him from the dead. Yeah. That's mature.
That's right. Mm-hmm. He was able to integrate the promise.
Yeah.
Now that took some faith, because this looked like this was a flat contradiction of the promise,
mm-hmm.
didn't it?
Yeah.
But he was able to take the promise and wed it together with the commandment. See, the word is, particularly the gospel, is not simplistic. It speaks of things like the removal of sin. Let me think about it. The removal of sin and the satisfaction of God and the justification of sinners and sanctification and eternal inheritance and illumination and a whole lot more. Those are big items. And if someone doesn't know anything about those things, a personal testimony like, it doesn't have any weight.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So here's someone, they don't know anything really about Christ. They can't testify of the gospel. They don't know what God's doing. They say, Jesus healed me. What?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what weight does that have?
Mm-hmm.
See, the word of your testimony is one of the things that gives weight to overcoming you. But it's not the total thing at all.
Yeah.
And all these people could say was, we saw him do a lot of miracles.
Mm-hmm.
Who is he? Well, we're not really sure who he is. But some folk think it's one of the prophets.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Brother Jason.
Mm-hmm. One of the issues with Jesus was this, how he was going to show that what kind of Christ he was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Because the people had one understanding of what the Christ would do, but it didn't fit, see, with what what he was sent to do. And so this is why Jesus, if you read the Gospels, you realize Jesus didn't stand up and with a megaphone and say, I'm the Christ.
That's
he didn't do that.
No.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason was because that was only going to be understood fully after he'd risen from the
dead.
That's
right.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it'd be understood in the context of their understanding.
Yeah.
And
uh-huh.
it's going to involve the cross, too. I think
Amen.
That's the main.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was declared by one of the apostles in a sermon in the book of Acts as the Lord's Christ.
The Lord's Christ, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That involves his agenda, his purpose, his will.
His death is where the transaction was carried out, and
uh-huh.
his resurrection is where it was confirmed.
Mm-hmm.
And until those things happened, the testimony, he didn't have strength.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Can you see that?
Yeah, amen.
The word of testimony The thing that makes it strong is it's supported by who Christ really is, what he did and what he's doing. There is a, in understanding the things of God, and particularly the gospel, there's a breadth and length and depth and height to it. It's multidimensional, and it's very profound. And God's intention is that all the saints will comprehend it.
Yeah, amen.
The length and height and depth and width, that you'll comprehend with all saints.
Yeah.
Was the length and height, that so forth, that know the love of God that passes all, it is the love of God that passes all understanding.
Uh-huh.
See? That's what God intends. And until some measure of that has been experienced, personal testimony is like a weightless moat. It doesn't have any part. That we're not denigrating the fact that those things happened. Mind you, we're not saying they're not valid. That's not what we're saying. We're saying that the person it happened to doesn't really know what happened.
Yeah.
How long was it? You that are were baptized, how long was it before it registered on you about walking the newness of life?
Yeah.
I know this isn't what we heard.
Mm-hmm.
See? We didn't know thee.
Mm-hmm.
But when you did know it, you know what power it, it added to your. You were not intimidated if someone didn't accept it. This didn't affect your testimony at all.
Uh-huh.
Jesus will commit himself to that kind of person.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. He'll teach that kind of person.
Yes.
He'll teach him. Teach them of God. Show them the truth. See, there are implications. Implications are interrelationships. The idea is A and B fit together, and C fits with them, and you know it all fits together. Some people read the Bible and they see contradictions. That's what they see. We read the same book and we see intra. Connection.
That's right, yeah.
See? Mm-hmm. But see, that's what makes the Bible. You can't destroy it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This thread of redemption is woven all through Scripture. You can't unravel it.
Mm-hmm.
You can't undo it. This is where the translators see they're in a, poor guys, I feel sorry for them. If they don't have this understanding, they goof up.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
You've got to see this. You can't interpret Scripture A like Scripture B didn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
And it pawned it off by saying it's the author's intended meaning. Mm-hmm. This isn't the way it works.
That's right.
See, God's the author.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the people that wrote it, they didn't see the prophets. They wrote truth.
Yeah.
They didn't see it.
Mm-hmm.
But after Jesus died and rose again, see, this changed the setting. See, if Jesus, it is, now Jesus will not break a bruised reed or quench a smoking flax. He will not do it. But he'll not take a bruised reed and a quenching flax, and smoking flax and commit himself to them, because that would break the reed.
Yeah, that's right.
And that would quench the smoking flax.
Amen.
It'd be more, see? It'd be more than they could process.
That's
so
right.
It's gracious.
Yes.
That we are kind of ignorant at the first.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because if this whole thing burst on you, you couldn't.
Yeah, that's right.
You couldn't hold up. And so, sometimes it's hard enough after you've been in a while. It's hard enough. See, and then he adds, he knew all men.
Yeah.
Some of the other versions say he knew what was in everyone. He knew what people were like. He understood people. See, one of the traits of a novice or someone weak in the faith or a beginner is they are tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine.
Yeah.
They can't avoid this. This is why it's foolish to tell a novice, say, go home and just read your Bible and try and find a church that preaches the Bible. You got to think of a little better way to deal with people like that.
Mm-hmm.
You got to show them something. Help them to perceive something.
Amen.
even a Philip says, come. Mm-hmm. I found him. We found him. Mm-hmm. Come. See.
Amen.
Now, I want to touch on this. He knew and needed none that any should testify of man, for he knew. Mm-hmm. He repeats this. For he knew what was in man. Now, I want to ever keep before you the circumstance under which this was said. Many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. See, that would really qualify somebody in a modern church setting. This would say, whoa, look at this. But it didn't qualify them for what Jesus really came to do. It was introductory knowledge. Now, where you have a person or a congregation that majors on introductory knowledge, they've shut the door of understanding. You got to really see that. This is not an innocent thing. This is not innocent. They've closed the door because Jesus will not, see, he won't commit himself. Yeah. To people on that level. And we've got to have, if we're going to survive, Jesus has got to commit himself to us.
That's right.
He's got to tell us what he's doing and entrust us with the truth.
Yes.
But he won't do it until we have some kind of stability. I suppose that just some places, if you just announced, you stood up and announced, many believed on him when they saw the miracles that he did. This would call it an eruption of praise in the average TV ministry. Just the report of this would be like, wow, you know, what did. But that's not how John approached this at all. See, this is how men inspired by the Holy Spirit, I'll give you an example of how they respond to people who do believe. Yeah. Now, Peter preached on the day of Pentecost, and there was the people convicted the people.
Uh-huh.
They cried, "What shall we do?" See? All right, what are you going to? So Peter tells them what to do now. Uh-huh. Says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the Holy Spirit." Now, if that were a modern church setting, it's as soon as we're done, you can go home. This isn't what Peter did.
That's right.
He knew that they were not in a position yet to have Jesus commit himself to them. Jesus is not going to teach him until something else happens. So before, this is before he baptizes them now.
Yeah.
So before he baptizes them, or they baptized him, it says, with many other words,
yeah.
So this is all kind of a lengthy thing, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. An untoward generation headed the wrong way. It's headed into the pit.
Yeah.
Before he baptized them. I never heard anyone before they were baptized told this. I'm sure somebody has, but it wasn't in the circles I was in. They didn't say this, but this ties right in with our text, brethren.
Yeah, yeah.
Save yourselves. You're in a generation that's headed for the pit.
Yeah.
You've got to sever yourself from this generation. Be ye separate, saith the Lord. See, he preached it on the day of Pentecost. This is what he was saying. A similar word to those in Christ is a similar word. This is Hebrews 3:12. Take heed, brethren.
Uh-huh.
Take heed. Lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief and departing from the living God.
Mm-hmm.
See, if you're in a backward stance,
yeah.
You got to listen to this.
Uh-huh.
Jesus will not teach you.
Yeah. That's right.
He'll not commit himself to you if you're in this backward stance.
Mm-hmm.
Why not? Because it'd crush you.
Yeah.
His teaching is too weighty and too authoritative. If a person's not committed to the Lord, boy, he hears words like, except ye pick up the cross and follow me every day, you can't be my disciple. Boy, that'll crush a bruised reed. But if you're in Christ, that'll come home to you. You'll believe it. Another one, James said to a group of carnal Christians, draw nigh unto God and he'll draw nigh unto you. Then he shouts out, cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Talking to the church.
Yeah, that's right.
Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Why is he saying that? Jesus won't commit himself to people who fail to do that. I mean, you may go home and pray about it and so forth. Jesus didn't say pray for the conversion of the world. Mm-hmm. He said preach.
That's right. Amen.
That's what he said.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He didn't say everybody go home and pray. He said preach.
Yeah.
Go everywhere and preach the gospel. Preach it. And if people pay heed to it, it'll whet their appetite.
Amen.
And they'll begin digging for the precious treasure. And when they do, as they're in that process, Jesus will come alongside and he'll teach them.
Mm-hmm.
And he'll show them the way. And he'll say, this is the way.
Mm-hmm.
Go ye in it. See, he'll instruct them. This is what Jesus will commit himself to people who have made a commitment to him.
Yeah,
he'll do this.
Yeah.
He needed not that any should testify of man. When it comes to the capacity and nature of man, there's a lot of naivete in the modern church. But it was not so with Jesus. See, there's all kinds of explanations for why people are the way they are. I don't care where you are. If you bring up the fact that the church is deficient, somebody will respond by saying, yeah, but we can't be perfect. We can't be, we got to be patient.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody will try and explain
mm-hmm.
why this condition exists. See, the church has never got used to what Jesus demands of it. And it's kind of bottomed out in our
mm-hmm.
in our day. That's what's in man. This is what's in man. That if grace doesn't come in, and if the Spirit doesn't tutor, if the Holy, and if Jesus doesn't teach a person, this is what's in man. He'll go down. He'll go. He just can't survive. He may read his Bible all the time. He'll still go down. He knew what was in man. But see, it's necessary that man knows what's in man. A man's got to know what's in him. I know that in me. That is in my flesh dwells no good thing. Oh, Jesus will commit himself to him.
That's right.
Isn't that good to know?
Yes.
He'll commit himself to a person like that because he knew. He knew what was in him. See, the people of God are called light. Ye are, not should be. I know the world's, church world says we should be light. God set us here to be salt and light. We should all try and be salt and light. No, Jesus said, you are.
Yeah, right.
Uh-huh. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. And if you aren't, you ain't in.
That's right.
That's just the way it is.
Amen.
We're called a children of light and a peculiar people. And he says that you're dead.
Yeah.
Your life is hid with Christ in God. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, you notice. When you read the Gospels, you notice that there's different kinds of people around Jesus. There's, they're called the crowds.
The crowd, yeah.
The crowds. That's kind of, could be just anybody curious.
Yeah.
You know? Then sometimes it says disciples.
Disciples, yeah.
But like later in John, it says some of them left him and followed him no more. Then it says that there was the 12.
The 12.
There's the inner circle. And then on the Mount of Transfiguration, there was three.
Yeah.
So you get all the way in.
Yeah.
See, there's these different kinds of people around Jesus. Now, I think our text is talking about the crowd.
The crowd. That's exactly
this is the out.
That's exactly it.
Uh-huh.
I remember, I think it's in Luke, Jesus said to his disciples, and this was near the end He said, "Don't be afraid, little flock. The Father is pleased to give you the kingdom.
That's right.
See, it's like when he said the parables. He said, to you the secrets have been given, but to them outside I speak in parables.
That's right.
Proud.
So there's this division, see.
That's right.
Jesus wasn't he's not going to trust these people. He's not saying to them, "I'm going to give you the kingdom."
No, no.
But he did say that to somebody.
Oh, yes, amen. He sure did. Mm-hmm. And he did commit himself to something. He said, right. "Whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, I'll do it."
That's right.
He's committing himself to somebody. Yep. See? Yeah, but here.
Is this the same thing as about the parables? He said, to them, it's given them in parables?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, see, when he explained the parables, he was committing himself to them, yeah.
The exact same example there, that his disciples proved that they were farther than the rest when they came to him and sought the understanding
because
they didn't understand the parable. So that's when Jesus opened it up. And so I was considering what we've been talking about tonight. And the crowds that were those that were outside, the Lord did not commit the weighty things of the kingdom to. But those who sought him, how did they come to Jesus? Why were they different from the rest? Well, if you remember the account, at the beginning, Jesus called them.
Yeah.
Jesus called his disciples to himself. And that was the initial contact that they had with Christ, is he drew them.
Yeah.
And so when they came to him, then that's when they were proving themselves to entrust themselves to him so that they were worthy to receive the kingdom.
He said that great invitation, Matthew 11:28, he says, "Come unto me. Learn from me." That's committing himself. That's committing himself to them. In other words, Jesus does want to commit himself.
Amen. That's right.
He does want men to know his mission and the glories of it and the benefits of it, but there's only certain kind of people he can tell it to.
Amen.
Yes.
We talked about this a lot previously, that a lot of this Jesus was about preaching and teaching and healing, but a lot of this is being done for these 12
with him.
He's teaching them. Like they saw that Jesus didn't give himself to men, so he's teaching them about this aspect of men.
And when they wrote up the gospel, they said this is what Jesus began to do and teach, that that's what they had seen it. They were raised up as eyewitnesses.
Brother Gibbon, isn't this the same thing, that Jesus will not commit himself to those who continue to remain in the flesh? Because the flesh profits nothing. So you have to deny all flesh in this before Christ will commit himself to you.
Yeah, they don't even get the gospel.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the person lives in the flesh, he's just cut off, that's all. Some people, see, they initially... they see enough to Christ to kind of make a separation from the world. It's surface. It's not what you're talking about. It's a surface separation. Some people followed him, remember, and then after he gave that dissertation, Bread of Life, many of his disciples, see, they left him and never went back. That's when he began to speak things, and they didn't understand him. See, they didn't know. He knew what was in him. That's why he talked the way he did to that crowd. He knew everything is in man.
Uh-huh.
And so he talked so that eventually only the interested people would say, "To whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of life." That's not what those others thought. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a death knell when a person walks in the flesh. That's a death knell. He knew what was in man. See, now God has spoken... why God reacts as he does to people. Mm-hmm. Here's what Jeremiah said. "Your iniquities have turned away these things, and your sins have withholden good things from you."
Yeah,
a person says, "That's a bunch of bad stuff happening to me all the time." It's not, we're not talking here about persecution for righteousness' sake. Mm-hmm. "Bunch of bad stuff happening to me all the time. Why is it happening? These things are withholding from you because of your iniquities." He won't commit himself to these kind of people. The psalmist said,
Psalm 107:33. He turneth rivers into a wilderness. You'd think normally it'd be the opposite way. He turns rivers into a wilderness and water springs into dry ground, a fruitful land into barrenness for the wickedness of them that dwell therein. See, you started out. You had available to you all these rich treasures. Everybody starts out with access to all these things. But because your iniquities, I dried up. I dried up the area. And I refused to commit myself to you. You see that?
Yeah.
Oh, this is something to behold.
This statement that you said, this is, there was something in those people that disqualified them.
Yeah.
But see, it doesn't sound like he asked their opinion on it.
Yeah.
He knew what was in them. He didn't have to ask them. He knew it. And see, but they didn't know it. But before it's over with, they're going to get some sense of it.
Yeah. Now let's have here's the response of a man who believed God knew everybody and knew everything about him. So now here's a person who has a right heart. Here's what he says. He says, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting, my uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Mm-hmm. Then a little later he says, search me and try me and see. See, the person with a good heart, when he knows that Jesus knows men, if he's known by anybody, he wants to be known by Jesus. Because Jesus, what he finds, see, if you're sensitive, what he finds, he'll purge it out.
Yeah, that's right.
Here's what Jesus, he's a refiner.
Mm-hmm.
He's a refiner. That's what Jesus is.
Uh-huh.
So you see, I want you to search my heart and see if there's any wicked way in me. He'll search it. When he finds it, he'll purge it out.
Amen.
Or let's say it like John said. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin.
Yeah.
No confession there.
Yeah.
See how wonderful that is.
Amen. Amen.
So Jesus wants you to, Brother Silas, go ahead.
Jesus doesn't just leave anything alone. If he finds something, he either cuts it off or adds to it.
That's right. That's amen. Good.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Now, this we've talked about a sensitive area tonight, and we want to be careful not to extend ourselves into unlawful areas like trying to analyze the other person, you know.
That's right.
Jesus knew what was in man, but we just know generally, you know. But he knows specifically.
Yes.
We can say in the flesh dwells no good things, but you can't really probe any other person's heart and find out all of the dark spots in it. But Jesus can and does.
Amen.
If ever you sense you're having difficulty comprehending something, I'm sharing with you now how I think. I search to see what is there that's blocking this. And generally, I'll find something. A little slow, so I'm having a hard time catching on to this, you know. And it doesn't have to be like a bad sin, necessarily. But something, some association, something is causing that. And your job is to find out what it is. And sometimes it's not all that easy finding it out. But you'll finally come up. You'll finally it'll surface where you have to choose between A and B. Now you know, I didn't know. I just thought you was talking about, you know, getting a new car. Oh, I got diverted at that point. See? That's what happens. And as soon as you recognize and clean up your act, so to speak, Jesus will commit himself to you. He'll tell you what God's doing. He'll open up the scriptures to you. He'll lead you gently, see? And you'll grow. And spiritual growth doesn't have to be it's a lifelong process, but growing up doesn't have to
take a whole lot of years. Yeah. Brother Jason.
The disciples, I'm talking about the 12. The 12.
Yeah.
It's very obvious they didn't always understand.
Oh, no. Mm-hmm. Very few times did they.
Yeah. Jesus often would rebuke them. He said, "Oh, you have little faith."
Mm-hmm. How long
sometimes he'd say, "Don't you yet understand?" And he'd rebuke them.
Yeah.
But I think the thing they had going for them, mm-hmm, is that they followed Jesus.
You're
they
right.
they yeah. did stick with, except
You're
for Judas,
right.
Who was a son of perdition.
Yeah.
That's right.
He wouldn't leave.
But those men stuck with Jesus.
Yeah.
They stayed with him and they followed him.
Mm-hmm.
Even when
mm-hmm.
remember Thomas, Jesus said, "I'm going to go to Jerusalem."
Yeah.
Thomas said, "Let us go and die with
Let's
him."
Let's go
yeah.
die with him.
And Peter, you know, he said, "I'll die with you." And I think he meant it.
Yeah.
Oh yes, uh-huh. he did.
He wasn't just blowing smoke. He meant it. Now he had his own sifting
mm-hmm.
when he denied Christ, but he meant that.
Oh yeah.
yeah.
So those men followed Christ, even though. And see, what happened is later they understood.
That's mm-hmm. right. That's right.
They did understand, but if they hadn't stuck with Jesus, they'd have never understood.
Yeah.
See, so that's the key to discipleship.
There was this mass, apparently a mass of people left him.
Uh huh. Yeah.
There after he fed the 5,000,
mm-hmm.
many of his disciples, they left him. But Peter says, "But to whom shall we go?"
Yeah.
They refused to leave.
That's right.
Yes, Rachel.
If we want to be with Christ, we have to confess our sins and run the race and stay on the track, and we will be with him.
That's right. No
yeah.
sense, Sister Rachel. That's good.
Yeah.
Yes, Sister.
I was thinking, too, that this committing of Jesus, since he did what he did in salvation, then he was able then to be able to commit himself to a body of people,
right.
of his own people. So now you can be in a body that Jesus is willing to commit himself
yeah.
to and to teach you.
He's there in the midst
yes.
of them.
Yes, amen.
Mm-hmm.
So he's not in the midst of them as an onlooker.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's a teacher. That's
right.
exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll work through the members of his body and communicate a variety of things. Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes, Sister Barb. Yes, amen.
I was
yes.
about the same things where Jason was again being persistent whenever Jesus is near.
Yeah.
There's several examples whenever he was here in the earth ministering that people were persistent, that Jesus made like he was going to pass by.
Yeah.
And the people persisted that he
yeah.
stayed with them. Or the woman who was seeking healing for her daughter, the Lord
kept.
Knew what he wasn't
yes,
going to
that's right.
the situation, and she continued to press harder.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was like he threw the ball in Jesus' court and Jesus tossed it back and he responded, "Lord, I believe."
That's right. Amen.
So those that persisted, those that continued
Amen.
To sin toward Christ, they were the ones rewarded with the knowledge.
Always were honored. Like what he said to Mary, "Mary has chosen a better part and it shall not be taken from her."
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Brother Ricky? Heated up, that's right.
Because it has to be seen.
Yeah.
It has to be brought to the surface.
Amen.
And then it can be appropriately removed. And I know that God can put us in circumstances that help us to be able to recognize those kinds of things.
Oh, yeah. It'll boil things to the top.
You know, like, and I'm not picking on Peter here, but when Peter was sifted, it helped him to see more about who he was.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
It wasn't just all over. And he didn't just explain it away by saying, you know, we all just make mistakes. I'm just going to forget this and move on. I don't doubt that became a point of intercession.
Oh, yeah. He knew why he sank.
Anytime you have like an ungodly reaction when you're in a hard circumstance,
yeah.
you never want to explain that away.
Amen.
I was just in a hard circumstance. You never want to explain
yeah.
it. Now it's time to confess because then that becomes an opportunity to remove.
Amen.
So anytime we find ourselves in those kind of situations, we react bad. This is time for some introspection.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The Lord's doing some refining.
Yes, Brother Judah.
We can know men generally, but Jesus knows them specifically. And there's a level on which we don't really need to know other men. can see Jesus, we can then examine ourselves and see what we need to do within ourselves so that we can be like him. We have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. It's him working in us both to will and to do with his good pleasure. So if we know Jesus, then we can also know ourselves better.
Yeah. Brother Jason struck on it there. The secret is in staying with Jesus or abiding in him.
That's right. Yeah, just to add to that, though, the disciples, Peter's a good example of this. Peter and the others, they had to learn that they actually didn't have what it takes just by themselves.
Yeah.
See, Peter, he had all that bravado. I think he meant it. Mm-hmm. I'll die with you. He said, he pulled his sword, was going to cut that guy's ear off in the garden. I mean, Peter meant business. But see, he had to learn that what it takes to follow Jesus was more than just like his own strength. See,
that's
Jesus said it.
Right.
He said, apart from me, you can do nothing.
Uh-huh.
See, they had to learn that. And once they did, then they were unstoppable.
Yeah, Jesus had to tell him, pull up your sword.
Yeah, that's right.
Pull up your sword. If I had to have someone fight for me, I wouldn't have called.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have called you. Yes.
Jesus.
Yes, he did.
Uh-huh.
Yes, he did.
And we don't know the hearts of men. We don't know what lies within men. But when we walk with Christ, the one that does know the hearts of men will speak through us.
Yes,
amen.
We cannot fully discern the power of what he is doing in us in any given moment.
Yeah.
But it is for us to heed the Spirit and be sensitive and remove whatever makes the Spirit's voice dull.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, some people may be very hard and callous, but they may be kicking against the goads.
Yes, that's right.
Huh?
Yes.
He said it's hard, isn't it? Hard to kick against those goads. So they were more, he was being being pricked hard.
Uh-huh.
See, so you never know who you're talking to. I don't think any one of those believers thought he was kicking against the goads, but he was. You represent Christ by your attitude and by your words, and then they'll have some influence. Yes, but Justin.
Yeah, the truth that you touched on earlier, he said it's given to you to know the mysteries, but then he speaks in parables, or the term of predestination, or everyone the Father gives me.
Yeah.
It's caused a lot of division among professed believers, and it's spawned all these different denominations and everything. And I was thinking about that truth earlier. God knows what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing.
Uh-huh.
He knows what's in man. Mm-hmm. And I was in the gas station earlier, and the gas station guy said, "Hey, would you like to, play the lottery?" And I said, "No, thanks." And he goes, "Are you sure it's over 200 and something million or something like that?" I said, he goes, "Well, there's this man. He says that if he wins this Powerball, he's going to give every man in Joplin $10,000. And the lady next to me goes, "Oh, that's just, would you imagine if he did that, if that was nice?" And I just walked out, and I was thinking, it wouldn't be right to give every man in Joplin $10,000. What if you gave $10,000 to a man that was a terrorist?
Yeah.
And he used the money to buy bombs? Or the thing is that men, they think that would be a great idea, that everybody gets the same thing, but they don't know what's in man.
If the solution was that everybody could have more, God could rain down riches like nothing.
If he gave an evil person unlimited power and unlimited knowledge, that wouldn't be righteous.
No. And you'd soon find out.
Yeah, that's right,
Remember the crowds who pressed on Jesus so much that he couldn't even function?
That's right.
Yeah.
Can you imagine what would happen if somebody started giving out money like that? It would be it would be a mob. It would be chaos. People would die.
They didn't even have time to eat.
People would kill each other trying to get to it.
Yeah, you can see the wisdom that Christ had. Now, he's getting ready to die. He's getting ready to go. So he dismisses these crowds that he knew that they weren't sincere. But so he just with a word, he just dismisses them.
Yeah.
And then he can focus, set his face like a flint to do the work that he was sent to do.
I would say they were intellectually sincere. See, but it was surface. It didn't reach down into the heart. Uh-huh. Sincere, I understand, means without wax, like a honeycomb.
Right.
A honeycomb, you got a lot of wax. Mm-hmm. That the more wax you got, the less honey you got.
That's
right. Yeah. All right, very good. We'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we confess that we want to be those to whom Jesus commits himself. And we do ask you to search us and try us, see if there's any wicked way in us, and lead us in the way everlasting. We thank thee for the strong incentives of being taught by Jesus. And we thank you for him. In Jesus' name, amen.